Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. The list of articles which has been chosen for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, and Thiruvananthapuram editions, are provided here. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping for the displayed articles is provided in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on to our first article analysis. This news article is about the 5th Governing Council meeting of Niti Aayog. The discussion will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance, then in Indian polity and governance, particularly in public policy, then also in economic and social development, particularly under sustainable development, social sector initiatives. Then the discussion is relevant in main syllabus under GS paper 2 in the area functions and responsibilities of the union and the states, government policies and interventions for development in various sectors. Next, in GS paper 3, the discussion is important under the area Indian economy and issues relating to planning, growth, development. Next, also in conservation. The news article talks about the 5th Governing Council meeting of Niti Aayog. We know that Niti Aayog is a think tank of the government. When we say think tank, it means a body of experts who are providing advice and ideas on specific political or economic problems. So, in India scenario, Niti Aayog gives such ideas and advice in the way of policy directions and guidance. That is, it provides strategic and technical advice to the central government and the state government. The Prime Minister of India is the chairperson of Niti Aayog. Now, the Governing Council of Niti Aayog comprises of the Prime Minister of India, Chief Ministers of all the states, Chief Ministers of all Union Territories with legislatures, that is the Chief Ministers of Delhi and Pondicherry. Then the Lieutenant Governor of Andaman and Nicobar Islands also. The Governing Council also consists of 4 Union Ministers as ex officio members and 3 union ministers as special invitees. Ex officio is a Latin term which means by virtue of the office, that is because of the office. The Governing Council is the premier or the principal body which has been tasked with the work of evolving a shared vision with the active involvement of states. This vision is in shaping a development narrative of national development priorities, sectors and strategies. The 4th meeting of the Governing Council was held in June 2018. It included the reviewing of measures taken for doubling farmers' income and progress made under flagship schemes such as the Ayushman Bharat, Poshan Abhiyan and Mission Indradhanush. Also, the Niti Aayog has been mandated with fostering or encouraging a cooperative federalism. This cooperative federalism will be carried out through structured support initiatives and mechanisms with the states on a continuous basis. This recognizes the need of strong states, as strong states make a strong nation. Then, Niti Aayog also seeks to design and assist the implementation of strategic long-term policy frameworks and program initiatives. And it will also monitor these policies' progress and efficacy. So, the Governing Council, which embodies all these objectives of cooperative federalism, presents a platform to discuss intersectoral, interdepartmental and federal issues. This is to accelerate the implementation of the National Development Agenda. Now, yesterday, the 5th Governing Council meeting happened. It was held under the chairmanship of the Prime Minister at Rashtrapati Bhavan. The meeting was attended by the Governor of Jammu and Kashmir, 26 Chief Ministers and the Lieutenant Governor of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, then also the Union Ministers who are ex officio members and special invitees. During the meeting, the PM said that the states should recognize their core competence and should work towards raising GDP targets right from the district level. The Prime Minister also highlighted the importance of the Governing Council of Niti Aayog as a platform to inspire cooperative federalism, as there is a need to collectively combat poverty, unemployment, drought, pollution, pockets of underdevelopment. Because all these factors restrain the progress of India. And as a whole, the goal is to realize the potential of the country so as to create a new India by 2022 and to create an economy of $5 trillion. Then to achieve the goal of becoming a $5 trillion economy by 2024, the Prime Minister urged the states to increase their economy. The aim is to increase the economy of the states by 2 to 2.5 times. If this happens, this will also increase the common man's purchasing power. The Prime Minister emphasized the need for every state to focus on increasing its share in the country's GDP. This shall be done by evaluating the export potential of the state and by determining the steps necessary for increasing exports and also boosting the employment. Next, the top agendas before the 5th Council meeting include the following. The first agenda was with respect to the efforts of the states towards water conservation. The Prime Minister urged all states to streamline and implement innovative water management measures. Also, remember that the creation of the Ministry of Jal Shakti is a key step by the Union Government. The Jal Shakti helps to develop an integrated and holistic perspective on water as a developmental resource. Also, it was decided that the rainwater harvesting to conserve water will be undertaken at the household and community level. This will be carried out by proactive policy and investment support. Various chief ministers presented best practices from their respective states also, and these practices can serve as templates for replication across the country. Under this, some of the innovative steps include the Jal Yukt Shivar Abhiyan of Maharashtra, which involves deepening and widening of streams, digging of farm ponds, etc. And the scheme made 11,000 villages drought-free. Then Mukhyamantri Jal Swalamban Abhiyan of Rajasthan, which resulted in 5 feet rise in groundwater in 21 districts of Rajasthan. Then the Mission Kakatiya of Telangana, which aims to restore irrigation tanks in the state. Next agenda, which the council considered carefully, was the issue of drought management and the associated relief measures. The need to safeguard Indian agriculture and protect farmers from the vagaries of unpredictable monsoons was highlighted in the meet. These included reviewing the district agriculture contingency plans of the states, then streamlining the provision of inputs such as seeds, and then making contingency or emergency plans for irrigation, etc. The agenda was the foundational reforms in the agri-economy, which will lead to a complete transformation of the agricultural sector in India. The core agenda items included the need to review the implementation of the Agricultural Produce Marketing Committee, that is the APMC Act, and the possible reform to APMC Act in the form of the Model APMC Act. Then also exploring the changes in the Essential Commodities Act was discussed. This is to ensure fair remuneration for the farmers, streamlining of supply, then driving more investment into the agricultural sector. The structural reforms in agriculture also include encouraging the corporate investment, strengthening logistics, and focusing on food processing also. In addition to this, the Prime Minister also announced the creation of a high-powered committee on structural reforms in agriculture. The next agenda was the commitment of the government to combat left-wing extremism. The Prime Minister assured the Council that the Ministry of Home Affairs will coordinate with all affected states of left-wing extremism. This is to decisively end left-wing extremism violence and drive the agenda of development in the affected regions. The Union Home Minister highlighted the initiatives taken by the central government over the last 5 years for ensuring development and security in the left-wing extremism affected areas. The initiatives such as the implementation of National Policy and Action Plan of 2005, which was very much successful, was discussed. Then essential steps such as deployment of the Central Armed Police Forces, which have helped to carry out sustainable operations against the Maoist, was also discussed under this agenda. With this, we have come to the end of this analysis. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on the United States Trade Representative which has said that no trade action will be taken against India as of now. The analysis of this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance, and in your mains preparation, it is relevant in General Studies Paper 2 under bilateral, regional and global groupings and agreements involving India and or affecting India's interests, and also under effect of policies and politics of developed countries on India's interests. The Office of the United States Trade Representative has said that no trade action against India will be taken at the moment. It also said that it will continue to raise the market access concerns with India. The news article has said that the media reports from USA indicate that US was considering to launch a 301 probe against India. So against these rumors, the United States Trade Representative has said that it has no such plans as of now. Now, we have seen two new terms, United States Trade Representative and 301 probe. Let us see these two terms in brief now. The United States Trade Representative, or in short USTR, is an office which is similar to the Ministry of Commerce and Industry in India. If you would have noted, today's topic largely deals with issues in foreign trade. So, the office of USTR is responsible for developing and coordinating US international trade, then commodity, and then direct investment policy also. And the USTR is also responsible for overseeing the negotiations with other countries. So, as a part of this, the USTR also manages the Generalized System of Preferences, that is GSP, and the Section 301 complaints or 301 probe. These two GSP and 301 probe are carried out by the USTR against foreign unfair trade practice. Now, 301 probe means an investigation that is initiated or started by the USTR under Section 301 of the US's Trade Act of 1974. If you see, this act also established the Generalized System of Preferences program, that is the GSP as well. Let us now see how this 301 probe process is being carried out by United States Trade Representative with the example of China. If you see, in August 2017, the USTR initiated an investigation of China under this section 301 of the US's Trade Act of 1974. Now, based on the findings of the investigation, in April 2018, the United States Trade Representative official announced that the US would take tariff action, and the first set of tariffs by USA started in July 2018. So, a 301 probe can be wide in scope. The 301 probe can result in two ways. One, US imposing tariffs. Second, taking other trade action against its trading partners if the parties don't come to any kind of settlement. Now, similar to this China example, the US media reported that the USTR will also start a 301 probe against India. But USTR has refused the rumors by saying that it has no such plans. USTR has also said that US will keep in touch with India to address the concerns of the US exporters. If you see, India has imposed significant tariff and non-tariff barriers for its imports. Here, tariff barriers means imposing tariffs or duties for the imports, and non-tariff barriers means other than tariffs or duties like means of policy regulations or quantity restrictions, etc. For example, like the e-commerce policy of India that favors the domestic Indian companies instead of foreign companies. The USTR has told that because of these tariff and non-tariff barriers, the US companies are suffering as they are not able to access the Indian market to export their goods and services properly to India. If you see, the comments from the United States Trade Representative has come at the same time when India has decided that it will impose tariffs on 29 American goods from today, that is June 16. And these tariffs will cause a tax burden of $220 million to $290 million for US. This is roughly about 1,500 to 2000 crores in Indian value. So we have discussed this news yesterday. Whenever you read the newspaper, try to collect and combine the news articles that have keywords like GSP, USTR, tariffs and retaliatory tariffs, etc. All these words are related to India-USA trade relations. If you see, we are constantly getting news on India-USA trade relations for the past 3 to 4 days and even for past months. And even our team has also discussed many of these issues. So based on the news articles and discussion, you can try to frame a timeline of the events that is happening and you can revise them for your mains answer writing. And from today's news article, we can say that the USTR might not take any trade action as of now. But a former US official has signaled that if there is no substantive or essential progress on the trade issues between India and USA, then a 301 probe was likely to be launched against India within the next 6 months. The official also added that India's commerce minister would have to show willingness to fix trade issues between India and USA. And only then trade actions by US can be avoided. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. Moving on to the next discussion, which is about the foreigners' tribunals. The discussion will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance, then in Indian polity, particularly in rights issues, because citizenship is a right. Then in main syllabus, it is relevant in GS paper 2 in the area government policies and issues arising out of their design and implementation. The foreigners' tribunals are in the news as the final list of the National Register of Citizens or NRC is to be published by July 31. This is on the directions of the Supreme Court. The final draft list of NRC was published on July 30 of 2018 by the Registrar General and Census Commissioner of India, who works under the Union Home Ministry or Ministry of Home Affairs. We know that NRC is the register that contains the names of Indian citizens. It is a register prepared after the conduct of the census of 1951 under the directive from Ministry of Home Affairs. These registers covered each and every person enumerated during the census of 1951, and it was kept in the offices of deputy commissioners and subdivisional officers. Then later in the early 1960s, these registers were transferred to the police authorities. But note that for the first time, the update process of NRC 1951 is taking place in the state of Assam. This update process means enlisting the names of those persons and their descendants whose names appear in any of the stipulated admissible documents issued on or before the midnight of 24th March 1971. The process is carried out based on Citizenship Act of 1955 and Citizenship Rules of 2003. The update process is being carried out to include only the name of genuine Indian citizens who are original inhabitants of Assam. And the update process is also being carried out to check the illegal immigration and then to detect and deport these illegal immigrants in the state of Assam, and thereby protecting the social, cultural, and economic and political life of genuine citizens in the state of Assam. Note that any illegal immigrant who came on or after 25th of March 1971 will have to be detected and deported to the country of their origin. So in short, it can be said that NRC will segregate the Indian citizens living in Assam from those who had illegally entered the state from Bangladesh after March 25, 1971. So, when the draft was published in 2018, it was noted that nearly 40 lakh people were excluded from the final draft. Then around 36 lakh people have filed claims against this exclusion. Now, this is the purpose for which the Foreigners Tribunals was constituted in 1964. The Foreigners Tribunal answers the questions of the central government that whether a person is not a foreigner within the meaning of Foreigners Act. According to the Foreigners Act, foreigner means a person who is not a citizen of India. So when such question is asked, the tribunal gives a reasonable opportunity to the person who is being questioned to give his representation. Then evidence has to be produced in support of the person's claim. Then a proper hearing is given to the person, and then after going through the evidence, the tribunal gives its opinion to the authority who has asked the question. So now, how many tribunals are there? As of now, the foreigners tribunal is unique to Assam. So at present, Assam has 100 foreigners tribunals across the state. But as 36 lakh people were excluded from the final draft, to give a proper hearing to them and to handle the large inflow of applications, the Ministry of Home Affairs sanctioned 1,000 additional tribunals. Out of these 1,000, 400 will be set up in the next 1 month before the final publication of the list. Now, each tribunal is like a quasi-judicial setup. It is headed by a member appointed under the Foreigners Act of 1946 and Foreigners Tribunal Order of 1964. And the appointment is also based on the guidelines issued by the government from time to time. A member can be a retired judicial officer of the Assam Judicial Service, or can be a retired civil servant who is not below the rank of secretary and additional secretary with judicial experience, or a practicing advocate who is not below the age of 35 years and with at least 7 years of practice. The member is also required to have a fair knowledge of the official languages of Assam, that is Assamese, Bengali, Bodo and English, and also a fair knowledge of the state's historical background, which is giving rise to the foreigners issue. Then also know that very recently in May 2019, the Ministry of Home Affairs amended the Foreigners Tribunals Order of 1964. It is now replaced by the Foreigners Tribunals Amendment Order of 2019. The amendment now empowers the district magistrates in all the states and union territories to set up tribunals. Earlier, such powers to constitute tribunals were vested with the central government alone. The amendment also provides for reference by district magistrates to the tribunal for its opinion as to whether the appellant or the person in question is a foreigner or not. The amendment order also empowers individuals to approach the tribunals. Earlier, only the state administration can approach the tribunal against an illegal foreigner. It also says that the final order of the tribunal on whether the person is a foreigner or not shall be given within a period of 120 days. That is 4 months from the date of production of the records. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is about the severe water crisis in the state of Maharashtra. The article discussion will be helpful in prelim syllabus under the area current events of national importance, and then also in general issues on environmental ecology. The discussion will also be helpful in main syllabus in GS paper 3 under the main heading environment, within which it is related to conservation. According to the National Institute for Transforming India, or Niti Aayog, India is facing the worst water crisis in the history. This statement was given by Niti Aayog last year. But day by day, the water crisis is becoming severe. So we can see more news articles related to water crisis faced by various regions in India, and more frequently than before also. We should know when to give importance to a regional news or a news related to a particular state. Day before yesterday also, we saw state news with respect to infant mortality rate reduction. That news is of national importance because the news said that the achievement of IMR reduction is because of national level program called as Rashtriya Bal Swasthya Karyakram. So, in main answer writing, if the effectiveness of such program is asked, you may highlight the results achieved in the particular state because of the program as an example. Here the thumb rule is that how important the news is at the national level. If you see, today's news is with respect to Maharashtra, that too with respect to the Marathwada region, but it is of national importance. Now let us enter into this discussion. Recently on 14 June, we saw how a particular residential complex in Chennai is managing the water scarcity when the whole city is stumbling in water crisis. That day, we saw about how rainwater harvesting can be helpful for India in battling or even driving out water scarcity. Because India is blessed by nature with tropical southwest monsoon and other rainfall patterns across the country. But today's news article states that Maharashtra is facing a severe water crisis. In about 8 of 9 major dams in Marathwada region in the state of Maharashtra has dried up. Some of the major dams in Marathwada region are Jayakwadi Dam, Majalgaon Dam, Lower Dhundna Dam, Yeldari Dam, Vishnupuri Dam, Manjara Dam, Manar Dam and Siddheshwar Dam. The picture in the news article is about a dam called as Veena Dam in Nagpur division of Maharashtra. In the UPSC preliminary examination this year, there was a question with respect to three water storage structures. They have given three places and asked what is common to these places. One of the places was from Maharashtra, which was Isapur of Maharashtra, and it is known for the water reservoir or dam constructed there. You may not sit and study all the reservoirs that are in our country. So it will be helpful if you could just give importance to those dams or storage structures that is currently in use. So now the state of Maharashtra can be classified into three regions. One, Vidarbha region, two, Marathwada region, and three, the rest of Maharashtra. This article is about Marathwada region. The term Marathwada means the house of Marathi people. According to Maharashtra government, even in 2013, approximately 40% area of Marathwada was drought prone. Within the region, Vaijapur Ashti belt is a major drought prone belt. These can be used as an example for you to cite in exam, and thus your answer paper will be appearing different from others. Now, this Marathwada region is one of the most affected in Maharashtra because of water crisis. To tackle the challenge, Maharashtra state government proposes interlinking of dams by pipelines and supply network across the region. Thus, they are planning to create a Marathwada water grid. The Chief Minister of Maharashtra has stated that the plan is to connect all dams in the Marathwada region with the help of the newly created Jal Shakti Ministry of the central government. See, you can suggest interlinking of dams as one of the solutions to tackle the water crisis. Already we have discussed about interlinking of rivers, rainwater harvesting and other examples. You may add interlinking of dams is also a possible solution for the problem. Now coming to the state, this year we saw a delay in the arrival of southwest monsoon. Arrival of monsoon is also called as onset of monsoon. The reason why we call the summer monsoon as a southwest monsoon is because the monsoon winds come from the southwest direction to India. In a normal monsoon, the southwest monsoon first arrives in India in the state of Kerala on June 1. But this year, we saw a delay of 6 days for the monsoon to onset in Kerala. This delay was also felt in Maharashtra as well. One of the major consequences of this delay is every year farmers hope it will be a normal monsoon, and they sow seeds accordingly. These seeds require water at the right time. But if there is a delay of 6 days, it will affect the entire cropping. Thus, the delay in monsoon spoils their hopes and leads to economic misfortunes. This is one of the reasons why they say monsoon is also a gamble. The monsoon delay was mentioned in the newspaper because the rainfall fills the artificial and natural water storage structures such as dams, rivers, ponds, lakes, etc. And the rainfall also acts as a valuable primary source of water resource. At present, the Maharashtra's dams have only 6.61% of the total capacity of water. There are 6 administrative divisions in Maharashtra. They are Nagpur division, Amravati division, Aurangabad division, Konkan division, Nashik division and Pune division. The article says except the Konkan division, water availability in the remaining 5 divisions is less than 10% with respect to the available capacity. Also in the news article, you will read a statement as 8 out of 9 major dams projects in the Aurangabad division are left with no water as of now. This is because the Marathwada region comes under the administrative divisions of Aurangabad, and within Maharashtra, the Aurangabad division is also called as Marathwada division. So in the news article, we can find that they have interchangeably used Marathwada for Aurangabad and vice versa. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. This is the prelims question which was asked this year, which I told you about. This is given for your reference. The displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next news article, which is about the ethanol production with the help of bacteria. The analysis of this news article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and also under general science. The discussion can also be linked to main syllabus under GS paper 3 in the area infrastructure, particularly in energy. We know that we have a very limited supply of combustible and natural energy sources, that is the non-renewable energy sources. These non-renewable energy sources are non-renewable, as the name suggests, and hence they are limited. So there is a demand for alternative energy sources that are renewable, which means they can easily be replenished. One among the alternative energy sources is the biofuels. Biofuels are fuels that are produced from biodegradable products and remains from agricultural production and forestry, and as well as biodegradable fractions of industrial and municipal waste. Ethanol produced from renewable energy sources is one of the most promising biofuels for the future. So India is also increasing its focus on biofuels. And for this, India has also released the National Policy of Biofuels in June 2018. Now, a new research and development is continuously happening in India to develop new technology for biofuels. So, as a part of this, the researchers from the Department of Biotechnology and Medical Energy at the National Institute of Technology in Rourkela of the state Odisha have discovered a marine bacterial strain. Marine bacterial strain means the bacteria that are found in marine or sea waters. This marine bacterial strain is called as Citrobacter species. These bacteria can produce ethanol directly from fruit waste. The Citrobacter species of bacteria was isolated from the marine waters near Digha and Shankarpur seashores. Both these places are located in the state of West Bengal. Almost 10 bacterial strains were found from these marine waters, and they were found to be highly tolerant to ethanol. All these bacterial strains were tested with various waste materials like kitchen, paper, fruit and garden waste for their ability to produce ethanol. So the ultimate aim is to convert the waste materials to ethanol with the help of bacterial strain, and the ethanol produced will be used as a biofuel. The researchers have conducted this new research because they are trying to develop a more eco-friendly and cost-effective method of producing a biofuel. At present, bioethanol is produced from the fermentation processes, and this fermentation process is the very common method of bioethanol production. The word bio is used in front of ethanol because the process of fermentation happens in the biomass, which is nothing but the organic matter. As you can see in this picture, the bioethanol production process involves some pre-treatment of the biomass or the organic matter. Then they undergo fermentation process. Fermentation means the chemical breakdown of a substance by bacteria, yeasts or other microorganisms. Fermentation is a metabolic process in which an organism converts a carbohydrates such as starch or a sugar into an alcohol or an acid. For example, yeast performs fermentation by converting sugar into ethanol, which is nothing but the alcohol. So from this picture, just know the simple concept that some pre-treatment of biomass is required in the normal fermentation process. What is meant by fermentation process? Here the word pre-treatment means treating the substance to liberate the sugars that are required for fermentation process. Now, the difference between this normal fermentation process and this newly developed method is that the marine bacteria was found to directly convert fruit waste into ethanol without any pre-treatment. Out of the 10 ethanol resistant strains which was screened, a particular species called Citrobacter SPE4 was found to directly convert fruit waste into ethanol without any pre-treatment. If you see, the waste material was powdered to enhance the bacterial activity, and thereby it reduced the time which was taken to produce ethanol. This powdered waste, along with the bacterial strain and mineral salts which are required for its growth, were introduced into the bioreactor. Bioreactor means a vessel that carries out a biological reaction for the conversion of wastes that are rich in sugar into alcohol. So, as a maximum output of 0.30 grams of ethanol was obtained from 1 gram of fruit waste, and it took over 24 hours to convert waste into ethanol. Out of all the waste materials that were taken for the study, the fruit waste was found to be the most favorable due to the high sugar content, and paper waste was the least favorable one due to the presence of cellulosic substances. The researchers have said that this method is environment friendly, sustainable and cost efficient since there is no pretreatment involved. Also, the species could be easily cultured under laboratory conditions. Culturing means growing the microorganisms under artificial conditions like in a laboratory. The researchers are also trying to genetically modify the species in order to increase the amount of ethanol produced. The researchers have also tested this bacterial species and have found that they are non-pathogenic, that is, does not cause disease. With this, we have come to the end of our analysis session. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the next session. Moving on to the last session for the day, which is the practice questions discussion session. If you look at the first question, it is about the governing council of Niti Aayog. Four options have been given and corresponding codes have also been given. If you look at the first option, it says the Prime Minister of India. Look, you have to know that Prime Minister of India is the chairperson of Niti Aayog. So, obviously, he will chair the governing council also. Here, the option one is an obvious answer. So, the correct code should contain option one. Then, if you look at the second option, it is about chief ministers of all the states. You may be confused whether chief ministers of all the states are included or not. But if you look at the codes given below, this option two is included in all the codes. That means it is in the correct answer. So, the correct answer should contain 1 and 2. Then, if you look at the third, it states Lieutenant Governors of Delhi and Puducherry. Today, during our discussion, we saw that some important officials from Delhi and Puducherry are included in the Governing Council. But were they Lieutenant Governors? No, they were Chief Ministers of Delhi and Puducherry. The exact words mentioned were the Governing Council also includes the Chief Ministers of the states and union territories which has legislatures. So, the union territories which has legislatures is Delhi and Puducherry. So, obviously, chief ministers from Delhi and Puducherry are only included, not lieutenant governors. But also remember that the lieutenant governor of Andaman and Nicobar Island has been included, which makes option 3 as the incorrect option. So, the answer should not contain option 3, but the answer should contain 1 and 2. So, if you look, option B, C and D can be eliminated from this because option B does not contain 1 and option C and D contains 3, which is an incorrect option. So, the correct answer or the correct code for this question is option A, 1 and 2. If we look at the second question, it is based on the National Register of Citizens, that is NRC. The question has given 3 statements. We have to choose which statement is the correct statement. Now, if you look at the first statement, it states NRC contains the names of Indian citizens. If you remember our discussion, we mentioned that NRC is a register that contains the names of Indian citizens. So, statement is correct. So, in the final options, if you see, option C and D does not contain statement 1. So, we can directly eliminate C and D. Now, we have to only confirm whether statement 2 is correct or not, because option A contains 1 only and option B contains 1 and 2. If we can confirm whether 2 is correct or incorrect, we can arrive at the answer. The statement 2 states that its update process is being carried out only in the state of Assam and Manipur. Now, we saw that after 1951, the update process is being carried out now only. So, but we discussed that Foreigners Tribunal is unique to Assam. So, why is it not unique to Manipur? Because there is no update process going on in Manipur. Okay, so remember that this update process is unique to Assam and the Foreigners Tribunal is also unique to Assam for now. If in future this update process is carried out in other states, we can include that. So, as of now, it is only carried out in the state of Assam. So, which makes statement 2 as an incorrect statement. So, the final answer, that is the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. But also know that here the statement 3 is an incorrect statement, because it states that the update work is done under the supervision and control of the Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. It is not under the supervision and control of Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. You may get confused by seeing Northeastern Region, but it is not. The update process is supervised and controlled by the Registrar General and Census Commissioner of India, who functions under the Ministry of Home Affairs. Okay, so remember this. Now, if you look at the third question, it may appear that these type of questions are tough, but they are not. The UPSC just wants to check whether you know at least any one of these places. If you could say about any one place and the state it belongs to, you are a winner. Now, today in our analysis, we saw that these places are associated with major dams, as the question states, as water storage structures. Dam is a water storage structure. And we saw the news article with respect to the state of Maharashtra and especially to the Marathwada region. So, the correct answer to this question is option D, Maharashtra. Now, if you look at the last question, it is about the Citrobacter species. The question states a newly discovered marine bacterial species called Citrobacter species, which is recently seen in news, is applied in which of the following process? Now, here all the options which has been given are applications or uses of various types of bacteria. But our question pertains to only Citrobacter species. So, if you see, today we discussed about production of ethanol. So, the answer should contain ethanol. Obviously, only option A contains ethanol. So, the correct answer is option A. Also know that this Citrobacter species has been recently discovered and it was used by researchers in the conversion of waste materials to bioethanol. With this, we have come to the end of today's sessions. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates on civil service examination preparation.